see what he was. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to another showing of The Atheist Experience. I'm your host, Ashley Perrien, and my co-host this week, Keryn Glasser.
Hi, I'm Keryn Glasser.
Welcome back.
Thank you.
We are live today, September 12th, and being sponsored by the Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. We have weekly meetings every Sunday at Crescent City Beignets on 6th Street, a couple blocks west of Lamar. Those start at around 11:30 and go until about 1, 2 o'clock. It's a very informal, very open, very social meeting. Any atheist-friendly people are more than welcome to come down and join us. That is our primary meeting for the week. Other things that we also do on, going back a second, that's every Sunday from 11:30. Save the third Sunday of the month when we have our lecture series at the Austin History Center on 9th and Guadalupe. Those start at 12:30. Next week will be one of those. We don't have a speaker lined up for next week. It's going to be a general ACA open house. Just come down, talk with everybody. We're going to be talking about the CFI deal that was on. We'll be giving an update on that. Basically just the ongoings of ACA in general. Again, that's next week at 12:30, Austin History Center, 9th and Guadalupe. Every Thursday, another thing that we do, we have Atheist Happy Hour at Antonio's Tex-Mex on the southbound feeder of I-35 just south of 183. That starts at 7:30, and just like the Sunday meeting, very open, very informal. Nothing official really going on there, just good times meeting other people. That goes from 7:30 until typically around about 10, 11 o'clock, something like that, more like 10-ish. All right. Some members of the ACA also have an internet audio show, The Nonprofits, which is every other Saturday on atheistnetwork.com from 2 until 3:30. They just had a show yesterday, I believe, and it's most likely available on the website. The next show will be September 25th, again, about 2 weeks from now. If you go to our website, atheist-community.org, they have a link to the radio show from there and a link to about at last half dozen or so episodes. It's an MP3 stream from, again, atheistnetwork.com every other Saturday, 2 to 3:30. Go ahead and check that out. Also, one final announcement of upcoming events. In October, the 8th through the 10th, which is Friday through Sunday, there will be the 2004 Texas Atheist and Agnostic Conference. That will be at the Holiday Inn on Town Lake, and we're going to be having a couple speakers there, Michael Newdow and Thomas Van Orden. Michael Newdow obviously has the Pledge of Allegiance case, and Thomas Van Orden was a lawyer having suits try and get the Ten Commandments monument on the Austin, Texas Capitol grounds taken down. Again, if you go to our website, we'll have a link there to get a little more information on the details on that. And that's it for announcements this week. Nellen, what we're doing this week, and for probably a little bit in the future, is one of the big books for Christian apologetics, is The Case for Faith. The show has been sent copies. A friend of mine got one from his ex. You got one from a recent friend of yours trying to save your soul. We've seen these copies everywhere. They've sold so many copies, and I think it was actually originally published, I saw in like the 52 or something like that, quite a while ago. But anyway, each chapter is supposedly some big argument, as in, here's why people are not Christian. Because the doctrine of hell is so bad. Because Christ is the only way to get to salvation. Because the problem of evil. Just all these different things. Each chapter is one of those arguments. So we are going to be going through and tackling some of these, because so many people have called into the show, said, have you read The Case for Faith? It's a wonderful book. It explains everything in there. No, it doesn't. So this week, we are going to do on this. We each have our copy.
Yay, look, see, and I got the one that's before,
yes,
it has the little,
I got the one
on
with
it.
The gold medallion edition.
Well, I just got the pre-gold medallion edition. I feel ripped off. Yeah.
But anyway, yes.
Well, you know, when I first got this book from a friend, he recommended I read chapter 6, which is the one on hell. And I read chapter 6, and I really enjoyed reading it. I really did. I thought it was badly argued. I thought it brought up some interesting things I hadn't heard before.
Yeah.
And I thought it would be a really fun thing to talk about on the show. But 2 weeks ago, you know, my brother, Russell Glasser, he talked about it on the show. So I thought I'd give you guys a break from that. And I'd do a different chapter instead. Well, last week, I got sent to Lubbock, and I was staying in a hotel with a coworker of mine. And when I was in this hotel room, I was compelled to play the famed atheist game, Hide the Bible, where you try and find a place to hide the Bible that the housekeepers will never find it. And then they'll have to replace it, and, you know, Gideon's group will end up spending lots of money buying new Bibles for the hotels. I don't know. Anyway, it's just fun. But it occurred to me that
Jeff D originally came with up a long time ago.
It occurred to me that the girl I was sharing the hotel room with wasn't an atheist, and I thought I'd pose it to her and see what her reaction was. And I said, you know, I explained the game to her, and she said, well, I don't really think we should do that because I forgot to bring my Bible with me, and I'm going to need to use the Gideon's Bible to do my daily reading. And I was like, you do it? Daily reading? She's like, yeah. I'm like, you read the Bible every day? She's like, yeah. I'm like, so haven't you read the Bible like over and over and over and over again? She's like, no, I haven't read the whole thing yet. I'm like, I have.
The atheist has.
You haven't read the whole Bible yet? Most of my friends have read the whole Bible at least once, cover to cover.
Well, that not knocks out the argument that people call in and say, well, if you just read the Bible, you'll be fine.
Anyway, So I said, so why do you read it every day? I mean, why do you read the Bible every day? She's like, oh, so that I can, you know, learn about Jesus' way and try to live my life like that. I'm like, so do you follow the Bible? She's like, well, yeah. I'm like, well, like, have you had sex before you were married? She's like, no. I mean, she's like, yeah. And I said, so are you going to try really hard not to have sex again before you get married? She's like, heck no. And I'm like, so all you have to do is read the Bible and then you're saved, right? I've read the Bible. So, anyway, that's my little anecdote. I thought it was funny because I thought it was very interesting that so many Christians believe that it doesn't matter how you live your life as long as you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior and you read the Bible. So I was really hoping chapter 5, which is titled, It's Offensive to Claim That Jesus Christ is the Only Way to God, would talk about that. I think that my initial reaction is that the title of this chapter is kind of a misnomer. I don't think it's necessarily offensive to claim that Jesus Christ is the only way to God. I think it's egocentric, and I think that every religion on the planet stakes a claim that their religion is the only way to God. I mean, that's not entirely true. Some religions, you know, squishily say, you know, as long as you believe in God, then you're okay. Or every religion has something positive to offer. But a lot of religions say, you know, our religion is the only real way to get to God.
Which he uses to deflate the idea that Christians are all arrogant.
Right. Right.
Says,
Well, he's not trying to prove that Christians aren't atheists. He's just trying to prove that all, arrogant. He's just trying to prove that all theists are arrogant. Everybody's arrogant. So you can't, you know, argue that, well, we're the only ones that are arrogant. Anyway, my problem is I don't think it's offensive to claim that Jesus Christ is the only way to God. I think it's a cop-out. I think that it's telling you that it doesn't matter how you live your life or what you do in your life or whether or not you follow the word of God or the word of Jesus, all you have to do is accept him and read what he has to say and read about him, and then you get to go to heaven.
Yep.
So if you're a murderer and you've murdered lots of people in your entire life and you're about to die on the chair, as long as the last thing that happens before you die is you say, I accept Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior, then you get to go to heaven. Yay! You can have a party every single weekend, and you can do very many debaucherous things, and then the next morning you can go to church, and you can tell the preacher about it, and then you're okay. But it spends the first part of this book talking about how every religion claims that theirs is the only right way, and so they're not any more arrogant than anybody else. So I was kind of disappointed that that's the angle they were taking. It does go into...
I do like, though, how they were talking about its exclusivity. And they do have a certain point with that, though, in that assuming you accept that Christianity is correct, let's say we get evidence tomorrow that the Bible is perfectly true, then if they pointed out that accepting Jesus is the way to get to heaven, then, like it or not, if that's the way the rules are set up,
then that's
they're right.
Right.
Whether
sure.
you know, liking it isn't part of the objection here. They're saying that we're right, like it or not.
Right.
And all religions say that, so I'm not harping on
that. We're right,
that
right, like it or not.
So, yes,
so
I mean,
then it goes into why we're right.
Science has the same thing.
It says we're right, like it or not, okay? And the reason we're right is because Jesus says we're right. And yeah. since Jesus says we're right, and Jesus is always right, therefore we must be right, right?
Of course.
Okay. Right. So,
and the reason they assert that is... Again, going back to the book, you can say that the resurrection of Jesus established him as being the Son of God. If that's true, then all our faith systems cannot be true, blah, blah, blah. And of course, now this is again a quote from the book, and of course, the historical record concerning the resurrection is extremely compelling.
Right.
Don't bother to back that up.
Don't bother
just
to back
accept
that up.
It, okay? Trust us.
They spend a large
trust
part
us.
Of this chapter then going into the reason why Christianity is right and everybody else is wrong. And the reasons include, they say that all other religions have some kind of inherent conflict with themselves. Like, they say one thing, and then they say another thing that doesn't mesh with the first thing that they said.
Yeah.
And they give a few really, really, really vague examples from a few different religions, and then they say Jesus never does that. Everything Jesus says always meshes with everything else Jesus always says, and therefore we know that Jesus is right.
Yeah. And they give two.
They don't give
count
any examples.
No. They actually, they gave, I'll give them credit
they
here.
They give two.
They give two examples. Buddhism. Buddhism generally does not have a god. It's kind of atheistic religion. So their argument is, they're trying to give you morals. They don't give you a god to give you the morals. Therefore, how can you be moral without God?
I can answer that question.
Yes, we've done that several times.
In fact, we just did that this past week. Someone emailed the TV Atheist list, and he was asking everybody why we can have morals if they weren't given to us by God. And I answered him, and I said, well, you know, I think that morals are all relative. I think that I know that if you touch your hand to a fire, it's going to hurt. And you're not going to want to touch your hand to the fire again because you're human and you learn from experience, okay? But if you touch a soft, squishy kitty cat, and it's going to feel good and you're going to want to do it again, right? That's why we tend to lean towards things that feel good and make us feel good and make us happy. Now, because we are human beings, we have the power of empathy and compassion. I can recognize that my grandmother died and it made me sad. So I don't want to force anybody else's grandmother to die because I know it'll make their grandchild sad too. And, you know, I know what it feels like to be sad and I don't want to make anybody else sad because that would be sad, right? I'm going to be doing a lot of this little repetition thing on the show. Anyway.
Sis, that was
so morals are all relative. I think that murdering someone is wrong because it does not lead towards happiness, which in my opinion, and actually Aristotle wrote a book on this called Values, is the ultimate intrinsic value. Everything that you do is in favor of being happy and living a happy life. Like if you want to be wealthy, it's just because it makes you happy. If you want to be, you know, healthy, it's just because it makes you happy. If you want to be rich, or you know, whatever, it's just because it makes you happy. So happy is the only intrinsic value. And that's where we get morals from. You know, not because
morals.
God said so.
Yeah. And the argument I usually use is all morals have a logical basis for them.
Right.
The reason you don't murder somebody is because the people around them are most likely going to get pretty ticked off.
Mm-hmm.
And so you'll either be locked up in prison or they'll come take vengeance on you, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, it doesn't create a harmonious society if people are stealing and killing from each other. And we like living in harmonious societies.
Right.
So therefore...
Because it makes us happy.
Exactly. It's a lot... We have logical reasons as to why to be moral.
Right. Because I prefer to be happy than to be sad.
Yeah.
It feels better.
Exactly.
It's so very simple.
So their whole moral
thing.
There's
not grand scheme about it.
There are ways that you can be moral without God.
Okay.
The other example I gave was Hindus believe in reincarnation. And each life is sort of payback for the one before. If you did really good in the previous life, then you'll be a king or a nobleman or something like that in the next life. If you're really bad, then you'll be a dog in the next life. Something like that.
Right. So you gave two examples, vague, general examples from other religions about why they are contradictory in themselves.
Exactly. They
he
don't
didn't
make sense.
Give any examples. What I said he didn't give any examples was he doesn't give any examples of why Jesus is right and never contradictory.
And the only one that I can think of.
I can give you lots of
examples. That comes up.
Because I've read the Bible.
Is basically Christianity teaches that you are hellbound. You are scum. Why? Not because of anything you did. But because of something your ancestors did.
Ah, well.
First one, Adam and Eve.
Well, actually, I can, I don't know. This kind of leads into the next thing anyway, but. Segue, sort of, kind of, vaguely, loosely associated segue. I don't know. Then, so in the next chapter of the book, so we covered the section of the book
next
where.
Section.
In the next section of the book, we covered the section where he says that, you know, well, of course, it's arrogant, but everybody's arrogant. And then we covered the section, and he said, well, Jesus is right, because he says he's right. And since he's right, we know he's right. Okay. So then it goes into the whole section about, okay, so what about morality? Okay. He tells this cutesy little story about this guy who, him and his brother were scoundrels their whole life. And the brother dies. And so the one guy goes to a preacher, and he says, I want you to give my brother a eulogy. And in the eulogy, this is all I ask, in the eulogy, I want you to refer to my brother as a saint. So the preacher stands up and he gives a speech and he's like, this guy was a scoundrel and a really bad person. He did all these horrible things in his life. But compared to his brother, he was a saint. So the point is, you know, when we play the game of, oh, relative morality, oh, you know, I might have had sex before I got married, but at least I wasn't Hitler, you know, because Hitler, like, killed millions and millions of people. Well, it's all bad, and they're all sins, and that's just the way that humans judge things, but God doesn't really judge things that way. See, the point is that God didn't send Jesus to earth to make us moral beings. God sent Jesus to earth to raise the dead. That's it. It says we can never be perfect beings because we're human, and no matter how hard we try, we're going to be sinners our whole life, so we might as well not even try. So God sent Jesus here just to bring the dead to life, which proves my original theory that I wasn't happy with, that you really don't have to do anything to be a Christian except read the Bible.
Yeah.
That's it. Just accept Jesus, live your life however the heck you want, because you're a sinner, you're damned if you do, damned if you don't, as would be said.
They also throw in a little point there, which I found somewhat amusing. They've got to take a stab every now and then when they can. They say that the fundamental tenet of atheism is the denial of God's very existence.
Yay! I want to talk about this. Thank
they
you for bringing this up.
There.
Denial.
They had to put it in there.
Denial. Denial. I'm going to flip back to chapter 6. I said we wouldn't talk about chapter 6.
That's very quickly.
But they brought this up in chapter 6. I haven't underlined or highlighted anything because it's not actually my book. and I haven't read this since... Ooh, somebody highlighted it. Anyway, so... I was reading this in chapter 6, and I got really excited, because in the first... the thing I like about this book is it really gets me going. Yeah. Have you noticed? Anyway, I was feeling burnt out about talking about atheism and being associated as an atheist and just having this be this big part of my identity, and I was talking about dropping out of the show. I'd talked about it with Ashley and all the other co-hosts, and then my friend gave me this book, and suddenly I'm charged up again. Okay?
She's an atheist again. Thanks to the case for faith.
I wasn't not an atheist in the first place. I don't know where it is because I haven't highlighted it or anything. But chapter 6 is about torture and burning in hell. And they go into this whole thing about when atheists argue against Christians, they use all these emotionally charged words to prove why hell is a bad place and any loving God wouldn't have it there. Like, why would a loving God commit innocent children to burn and suffer and torture for all eternity. Blah, 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 blah. They accuse atheists of saying all these emotionally charged words so that the answer is like, well, you can't answer that question without rephrasing it because otherwise it just makes God look like a bad person. But then they turn it around and they use, as Christians often do, a bunch of emotionally charged words against atheists, like this word denial, the word reject. You know, atheists choose to go to hell because they deny and reject God. I'm going to use lots of emotionally charged words here. Okay. I am a girl. I like fantasy and La La Lands. I have all the Harry Potter movies. I have lots of movies about princesses. I have lots of little fairy tale movies. All these movies that are coming out, you look at my collection, it's a bunch of fantasy, right? I love fantasy. I love unicorns and fairies and wicked witches and happily ever after. I would love to believe that unicorns exist in the world. I really, really would. But I don't. Does that mean I deny unicorns? Does that mean I reject unicorns? And most importantly, and this is the word I hear the most, does this mean I am against unicorns? No, I can't be against something that I don't believe exists, okay? I am not against God. No. I can't be against something that I don't think exists. I'm not against unicorns because I don't believe in things. I am very pro-unicorn. I wish they existed.
We don't deny
but I don't believe they...
We don't deny and reject them any more than we do the Death Star.
That's the Death Star.
Star Wars.
Oh, okay. Geek.
The Borg.
Sorry. Anyway, yeah. I have a little elf on my shoulder. See it? Do you see it? Does everybody? Zoom in on my shoulder. Does everybody see my elf? My elf is telling you to spit in my face. Okay? And if you don't spit in my face, he's going to pee on you.
Be careful. A lot of people will take you up on this one, most likely. You are on the atheist experience here.
My elf is telling you to give me $10. Okay? If you don't give me $10, he's going to pee on you. Oh, thank you. Look, you see my elf? Okay. My elf is telling you to give me $10.
We swear he's there. Don't worry.
He's there.
Trust us.
Don't you see him? You don't see him? Oh, my goodness. Okay. If you don't give my elf $10, he's going to pee on you. You really don't want me to pee on you. Wait, no. You have to give me $10 every day for the rest of my life, or after you die, he's going to pee on you for the rest of eternity. Okay. Now, by not believing everything I just said, are you against my elf? What did my elf ever do to you to piss you off?
What bad experience did you have with her elf that made you give him up on him?
Okay. Anyway, that was an extreme tangent. I was really wanting to bring that up at some point, and he segued into that so nicely. They use the words reject, denial, and against, and refuse.
Repeatedly.
Repeatedly throughout the entire book. Yeah. To prove that atheists basically are choosing their own fate.
Yeah.
You know, they insist that God has made it very clear to us that he's here, and atheists choose not to believe in him. That's not true. I can't believe in something that I haven't had compelling evidence for, and I haven't had compelling evidence for God. In the past, in stories in the Bible, he used to show himself to people. He had flaming bushes and big clouds in the sky and loud voices booming out of nowhere, and you know, he'd reveal himself to people, and he doesn't do that anymore, and yet he expects us to still believe that everything, you know, this, that the Bible is a compelling historical document.
Getting back to the chapter. Moving on.
Okay.
One of the things I like that they go over, though, is typically the idea of it's all this faith versus works. Mm-hmm. Christians usually say the only way you can get to heaven is through faith alone. Mm-hmm. Works don't really matter.
Works.
Other people say works, you should be living a good life. How can people who live a good life
go to heaven?
Yes.
Okay, right.
How can good works, if you're doing good works in your life, doing good deeds, why do you go to hell for that? And they use the image of Gandhi several times. Mm-hmm. Because Gandhi is supposedly, you know, such a good person, peaceful, and everything like that. And so they talk about Gandhi going to hell. And they're out for that. And they don't want you to think in this book. They really don't want you to think about things. They like that whole trust thing.
As evidenced by the fact that they have two atheists in the whole book. One of them is Lee Strobel, the author of this book.
Which is supposedly an atheist. Trust us, he's not.
And the other one is this Templeton guy who, as my brother illustrated 2 weeks ago, read a little section where he says,
he's crying.
I miss God. I mean, I miss Jesus. I think Jesus is the greatest person that ever lived, and I give my life to Jesus, and I try to live my life in his way. Okay? Not an atheist.
Yeah. But anyway, they're talking about Gandhi going to hell. That's such a terrible thing. How do you defend against that? And their answer to that is, and I quote, "We can be absolutely confident that whatever God does in the case of Gandhi or any other person, he will do what is right."
That's right.
Don't think about it. Don't worry about it. Trust us.
That's right. He says, it was beautiful. Oh, wait, I wrote down the page number, 157.
Yes.
He says, Abraham asked God in the case of Sodom and Gomorrah whether he was going to let the righteous die with the unrighteous. And it was wonderful how Abraham answered his own question. He said, "Will not the judge of the earth do what is right?"
Yeah.
Therefore, you can trust that everything that God does, no matter if he kills some person that you thought was innocent, the fact is that person wasn't innocent, or God wouldn't have done it, because God is always right.
Yeah. Trust us. We know what's best. God knows what's best. Don't worry about it.
Trust that God was right.
They also use this exact same argument on people in the world who may not have come across Christianity.
Mm-hmm.
Either they grow up in societies where Christianity is not accepted, or they live up in the jungles of Brazil or something like that, and they're just not part of modern society. They haven't heard of Jesus. And again, their argument is, I believe that if a person genuinely and sincerely seeks after him being God, not Jesus, there will be some way that God will make it available for that person to hear him. So again, trust us.
Right. Not only that. But, and it's not just if he seeks God, because, you know, if you've grown up in a place where you've never heard of God, it's kind of hard to seek him. But if you're open in your heart to accepting and loving God, then the way will become apparent to you. He says, God knows where we will be born and puts us in a position where we might seek him. And he gives the example of, perhaps you live in the middle of the jungle in Africa. And one day, out of the blue, one of God's friendly little missionaries from Wisconsin, you know, who's on a mission, is going to show up in the middle of the jungle because God knew to send that person there. So if you are a missionary, God's sending you to the middle of the jungle of Africa so that you can convert this little person who's never heard of God before because it's open in his heart. Anyway, and he says also, through visions and dreams, because, you know, someone in the middle of nowhere, he gives all these, he spends the rest of the last half of the chapter giving anecdotal stories, you know, of, and I've heard this from a friend.
Some Muslim woman.
Oh, yeah. Some Muslim woman was walking down the street, and she was feeling empty, and out of nowhere, she says, "Jesus, help me," and then she stops, and she goes, "Huh, where did that come from?" And then she says, "Well, if that just popped into my head, it must be because God was putting it there."
Now she's a Christian.
I've heard that similar anecdotal story. Mm. The most common kind of thing is, like, I was on a road trip, you know, and one of my friends wasn't wearing a seatbelt. And I turned to my friend and I said, "Hey, you should put your seatbelt on." And then, bam, we got into a car accident. And wow, it was a miracle, because if God hadn't told me to put her seatbelt on, then
she
would have died. Because God led us to that. Led you to a car crash. No, more importantly, God led you to know to put your seatbelt on when you're driving the car. Personally, I learned that in defensive driving, which was required in this. I don't know if it's required here in Texas, but where I went to school, you could not get your driver's license without taking defensive driving. Okay. It was required class. It's a law here in Texas to put your seatbelt on. Funny, the law in Texas to put your seatbelt on. I would like you to show me the section in the Bible where God says, "Wear your seatbelt." Okay? I don't know.
So yeah, they even go into the whole idea that, what about, like you were saying earlier, somebody's on death row, they've killed all these different people, and as long as they say, "Jesus, forgive me," then they're okay. Talk about David Berkowitz.
You know, we haven't even put the number up, and we already have two people in the queue.
Yes, and we will be getting to them relatively soon.
Right.
But anyway, talk about David Berkowitz. And they say, God has forgiven him if he has confessed and repented and sought God's mercy. Now, David Berkowitz is a Christian, according to his words in jail now. But the more he is in tune with who Christ is, the deeper will he is paying for what he has done. So in other words, his punishment is, trust us, he's really, really, really sorry.
No, his punishment is guilt. If you've hit a child in manslaughter because you were drunk driving and you killed the child, whether or not God ever chooses to punish you, if you repent for your sins before you die, you're going to go to heaven. But you're going to have to suffer from extreme guilt for the rest of your life. You're really going to feel sorry and bad about what you did forever. It's like, and it's like the book Crime and Punishment, basically. You know, he does this crime that he can get away with, and he does it practically perfectly. But throughout the rest of the book, he feels so guilty about it that he becomes really paranoid and really, you know, freaked out. And he starts, you know, assuming that everybody knows what he's done and everybody's going to catch him. And he eventually, I think, ends up confessing and turning himself in because of his extreme guilt that he has from having committed this crime. Yeah. That's basically your divine punishment is guilt. That's a very Jewish thing to say, I think. Okay.
So, anyway, as we were saying earlier, this is a live call-in show.
Yeah, you can go ahead and put the number up.
We're going to go ahead and put the numbers up and start getting callers in a minute.
I'd say the one last thing that I want to... I have all kinds of thoughts running through my head. This is very disorganized because I'm just going and going and going. Okay, I really wanted to talk about chapter 6, but we'll get back to that in a couple of months when we've talked about a couple other chapters. But the same friend that gave me this book also has written a paper on soulmates and whether or not he believes in soulmates. And he ends up saying he has some very valid points. I think his paper is very much on the fence. Like, he hasn't decided for himself whether or not he believes in soulmates, but here's some pro and some con arguments. He says that if you believe in soulmates, it can actually be detrimental to a relationship, because if you get in a relationship and you believe this person is your soulmate and you marry them, then everything's happy until something goes wrong. And then when something goes wrong, rather than wanting to fix the relationship and wanting to stick with it and make sure it's right and, you know, work on the relationship, there will be a thought that will appear in your brain that tells you, what if this person was not my soulmate and I was wrong and my soulmate is still out there? And then you will kind of unknowingly sabotage your relationship because you're not sure if this person was your soulmate or if the real soulmate is actually still out there. Okay, so he says in this argument, the best and most logical thing to do, since you don't know whether or not you have a soulmate, is to base every relationship you have not on a squishy feeling that you have, because you're attracted to each other, which will eventually fade, but to base your relationships on things that you have in common, and common belief systems, and common, you know, morals, and common values that you have with each other. Well, I find that really interesting because the word faith suggests to me that every Christian and every believer in the universe bases their relationship with God on a squishy feeling. I've heard this anecdote over and over and over again. I have a feeling. Even Lee Strobel gives that example somewhere in the end of this book that someone heard just prior to my coming to Christ, my sisters were exposed to the gospel and made their commitment. I came to believe in Jesus in two stages. First stage was when I heard the gospel publicly proclaimed in an auditorium when I was 17. I said to myself, something about this is true and I want it. That sounds to me like this kind of squishy, lustful feeling that people base their relationships on that eventually fades because it's not based on common beliefs and common whatever and facts and truth and knowing that you two are compatible or whatever. I don't know. So that's my thought to end on, and now we can go to callers.
So yeah, basically, going back to the case
book.
Of faith.
That was the case.
It's an interesting book. It is a lightweight in terms of argumentation and apologetics. Again, it's something that we've heard referenced on this show dozens of times. That's why we're kind of going through it here. But in terms of this specific chapter about Jesus being the only way to get to heaven and salvation, their main arguments are, well, other religions are exclusive too. They say they're the only ones.
They did it first.
And we know Jesus is right because we have the Bible.
Right, and the Bible says so. And the Bible is the word of God, and God is always right, and so therefore God must be right.
Exactly. So, Okay, point taken. And also they discuss, again, that whole good people go to heaven, bad people go to hell, by just saying, don't worry, God sorts these things out. You don't need to understand or to think about it. Just be happy.
Just they'll, trust us.
Yeah, they'll be okay. Don't worry about it.
Just keep on living your life as you would have. Do whatever you want to.
They don't explain things all that well, and kind of like the rest of the book. So, but anyway, we will be going over more of the book in coming months, dealing with other chapters at other times. Anyway, phone number is on your screen. Go ahead and give us a call, and we'll get you on the air. First, we have got Robbie. How you doing?
Hi, how you doing?
Okay.
Doing good, how you?
Hey, I just want to let you know about relationships I heard about. I just want to let you know, I have this friend named Rachel, and she has problems with another guy. And this guy, he's black, and his name is Danny, and he is he's kind of tall looking and kind of handsome and sweetie all the time.
Okay.
So I need I just want to let you know is it okay that God helping people like a girl and a guy being together or something like that?
If we assume that God actually existed,
yeah,
then maybe. But we don't think God exists.
Yeah.
Therefore, he's not the best marriage counselor in the world.
Yeah, I'm not sure I understand your question. You're telling me that there's a girl and there's a guy and they're together?
This guy, his name is Danny, and he is a consumer student from Arsenal, and he's a big tall guy.
Yeah, I just want to stop you right there because I'd like to protect the confidentiality of this guy on the show. So don't tell us too many details. We don't need to know that much about who he is.
Okay.
I guess trying to find out, what is the actual question that you have
My question is, I heard her, I'm going to talk to you. Okay, I heard you talking about something about ATLL or something like that. You said devil and everything.
Oh. We're talking about hell.
Hell?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I heard she said something about it. And is that like in devil's place or something?
What?
According to Christians, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I went to church for 4 years. And I need you I just want to let you know that I just want to know, I'm kind of down and everything, and I need help, you know. Do you know, it's for her, can you know any, do you go to church all the time?
No.
We're atheists.
I'm an atheist.
Well,
we're both atheists. We don't believe in God. We don't believe in hell. We don't go to church. Well, as a matter of fact, I do come from a background of being Jewish, and from time to time I go to temple on Friday nights.
Well, I have this friend of mine named Rachel. She's a Hebrew.
Okay.
And she knows Hebrew on the same time, you know?
Okay.
Well, I just want to let you know, guys, okay?
Okay. All right. Thanks for calling.
What?
Okay. All right. We are going to go on now. So if we can get our callers back, please. If I can see the list sometime. There we go. We have got Chris. How you doing?
Hey. I'm doing pretty well. How y'all doing?
Not too bad. What you got for us?
Well, a couple things. One, I'm a Christian.
Okay.
Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that I believe Christ is the only way to God, or that Christ was the Son of God, or any of that stuff that the popes later on started.
Well, I think being a Christian kind of means that you have to accept Christ as being the Son of God.
Well,
or
Christ,
am I wrong, or did you?
No. For the first 300 years of Christianity, Christ was not considered to have been the Son of God. It wasn't until one of the popes declared him a Son of God that he became a Son of God. And the
I have heard very few Christians actually say that.
Yeah,
and when I say that to Christians, they're like, what? You're crazy.
Yeah, that's a brand new one on me.
In fact, I was once talking to a Christian, and I told him that Jesus was Jewish.
Yep.
And he was like, what are you talking about? You're crazy.
Jewish,
Jesus wasn't Jewish. I'm like, well, then what was he? He's like, he was Christian.
He was a follower of the perennial philosophy.
Then where did Christianity come from? He's like, it was just always there. I said, believe me, talk to your preacher. Jesus was Jewish. He's like, you're crazy. Anyway, so go on.
Yeah, go on.
There's an expression. It's the perennial philosophy, and it's called this belief structure that has come up through certain very wise, very intelligent, very motivated individuals all throughout time. And they have all said basically the same, they've put down the same structure for reality. It's this basic, there is no sin unless you consider yourself to have done wrong. There is no, et cetera, et cetera. The true Christian, one who followed what the red text, if you know what that means, you know what?
Yeah.
The actual words of Christ,
yeah.
Would not ever, ever vote for, you know, going to war or that type of thing.
I think that's really
anathema to anything they believe in. And I would just like to make it clear that the Christians that you have been running into are not all Christians. There are other Christians in this.
I want to respond to two things that you've said. Okay. First of all, I agree. I think it's really interesting, and this was once something I wanted to work in somewhere, but I think it's ironic that so many people who are extreme Christian of some kind or another are also extreme Republican. And being extreme Republicans and extreme Christians, they think that it's bad and evil and wrong to make government take taxes from you that will then go towards things like social services and welfare programs and charity. Whereas what we should do is we should have government let us keep all of our money and promote as much as possible our own economic advancement, which I think is ironic because Jesus said in Matthew 9:18, sell everything that you have and give it to the poor. And then he later says, rich men will not go to heaven. He says, you know, things like, and this comes out of Judaism, Jesus said things like, you know, feed the hungry and clothe the naked and give shelter to the homeless, which I think is funny because, you know, I'm a Democrat and I'm a social worker and I give my life towards, you know, promoting social services and helping people out with welfare programs and giving to charity and helping them find their lot in life through whatever governmental means they can find. And people call me a squishy liberal with that air of disgust and that spit on the end of their tongue. And you know, I think it's ironic that particularly our president considers himself such an extreme Christian and yet is such an extreme Republican. I think I don't understand how the two always go together.
And as far as being a real Christian, again,
everybody that disagrees with one Christian
exactly.
has to say to another Christian.
There's apparently one Christian out there somewhere. and everybody disagrees on who that person is.
Every
and
time you hear something you don't like, they'll say, well, that person isn't actually a Christian.
The Bible is just so open to interpretation that that's kind of the problem with it, is if nobody can agree on what the belief structure actually is, then how can you trust any of it? Everything is under question. The Bible is a big book of multiple choice. You can support any idea you want using some verses in the Bible.
Right.
Therefore, which ones are correct?
And
how do we know they're true interpretations?
And we hear this all the time. Right. If a Christian hears an atheist say, I don't believe in God, then the Christian assumes that's because they haven't heard the right definition of what God is. And so they'll redefine God to try and prove that God is something that you can believe in. And if they don't like what Christian doctrination has to say, then they'll say, that's just because that person that was telling it to you wasn't really a Christian, but I'm really a Christian, and my doctrination says this. It's very easy to assume.
Have you seen or read, I think it's the Jeffersonian Bible or something like that, I can't remember offhand exactly the name. Basically what he did is just go through the Bible and take out the words of Jesus, compile them into a book, took out all the other, you know, supernatural stuff, and left that in there saying, this is a fairly good moral guideline to follow. But that was fairly interesting. He was a deist, actually. Thomas Jefferson. So, are you there? I think we have lost our caller, apparently.
I don't know. He's
on the line, but... Now
we lost
not.
Him.
We didn't do that. Chris, if you're out there and you still had words for us, go ahead and call us back. Sorry about that. I'm not too sure exactly what happened there.
He has words for us.
But yeah, the whole idea of, you know, they're not real Christians is, well, everybody says that one.
Uh-huh. Yeah, we hear that a lot.
So,
especially on this show.
Yeah.
Okay. At least once a week.
Anyway, let's go on to Guy. How you doing?
Hello. How are you?
Yeah, pretty good. What you got for us?
I mainly called to say that I'm a Christian who appreciates your program.
Okay. good.
And I think these days there's a lot of divisiveness with regard to...
religious intolerance.
Yes, a lot of religious intolerance. And I think, unfortunately, we Christians are guilty of a whole lot of that.
So are most. So are a lot of religions. So we tend to focus on Christianity on the show simply because it's the dominant one in this country.
Right.
If we're going to get a caller, chances are they're going to be Christian.
We just run into it the most. And we'll talk about other religions when other religions come up in the news or in callers. But, you know, generally, I mean, we're not trying to target Christians over any other religion. It's just more common.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. I think it's time for, you know, we don't own anyone's beliefs, and you know, the right fundamentalist right-wing Christians need to believe that you know, they're not always right, and they don't have the right to impose their beliefs on other people.
Yeah. Given that, I would like to see that belief out there more often, in terms of, we're Christians, but we don't assume that the government should be imposing Christian values on everybody else.
Oh, I can tell you, I definitely am against that.
And so what I would like to see is more Christians like you out there being vocal when the president or Jerry Falwell or whoever comes up and says, we're going to do this because God told us to, or because it's the right thing to do.
And all Christians like agree with us.
Exactly.
And all people who believe in God agree
Christians
with us.
Don't always agree.
Yeah.
And so get out there and say, you know, when Jerry Falwell's on TV or somebody's, you know, pushing religion on everybody else, tell them that, you know, look, you're a Christian too, and you don't necessarily agree with what they're doing.
Well,
they don't listen to us.
The thing, I guess, that really disturbs me the most about the far right and how the Republican Party is using it, or it's using the Republican Party, vice versa, is that, you know, it's like they own the flag, and then now they own Christianity.
Yeah.
And, you know, then you get people like Pat Robertson, Jerry Falwell, you know.
Yeah.
Christianity has become a business.
Exactly.
And that's not where all Christians are from.
Yeah.
Let me tell
you. And we definitely understand this. Again,
we have a friend who...
They're the most vocals.
We have a friend who's taught their children to refer to churches as God stores.
Yeah.
When you say that religion has become very, very much like a business. You go and you buy your passage into heaven by giving them money.
Yeah. Yeah, we definitely understand that not all Christians are the fundamentalists out there on TV getting frothy at the mouth.
No.
We definitely understand that. They're just, unfortunately, the ones who are most vocal.
Yeah,
and therefore the ones who actually get things done.
So. No, and it's the ownership thing that they have, that those type of Christians, where they create a problem with me. It's like they own the flag, you know.
Yeah.
And
they try to, at least.
They own that, and they own patriotism, by the way.
Yes.
Patriotism,
definitely.
They own that.
Yes, you cannot be a patriot and an atheist.
Oh no, absolutely.
Doesn't happen.
Well, listen, I just wanted to say that I have enjoyed listening to y'all's show, and will continue to do so. And, you know, you have a pretty free mind on Christians anyway. You're not real redneck on that issue anyway.
I try not to be.
Well, it is Austin.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's true. It is Austin. Why I moved here, to tell you the truth.
Yeah.
But anyway, I've enjoyed talking to y'all, and I appreciate you having me on your show.
Okay. Thank you very much, Colin.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
All right. Again, phone number is on your screen. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, snide remarks, anything on the case for faith, go ahead and give us a call. Okay. We have got Charlie. How you doing?
Hi.
Okay, you there?
I'm new to the area.
Okay. How can we help you?
Welcome to Austin.
Yeah, it's some of the most enlightening television I've ever run across.
Thanks.
Keryn with a Y.
Yes.
You are special.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you for carrying the flame of truth. I think it's beautiful how you don't even choose to wear makeup when you're on television. You don't need it at all.
I am wearing makeup.
Do we have any questions?
Oh, gosh.
Not very much.
That's embarrassing. I'm so sorry.
Do we have any questions, though?
Well, no. The reason I was calling was the question between fighting Islamic terrorism and not believing in God, there has to be an answer in there in the middle somewhere, because I don't want to die at the hands of some God-fearing militant, especially when I'm not a God-fearer at all.
Okay.
I believe in the reality that is and was and will be.
Okay.
Okay.
So, I mean, how do we reconcile the two? The two factions of the fighters there.
Well, you know,
I kind of
okay. Are you talking about how do we reconcile?
Well, I mean, I guess what I'm asking, and you really hate to say this in the reality that we live in now, but are we right to kill them because they want to kill us, no matter why they want to kill us, or should we kill them more and more often because they're God creatures?
Actually, that's interesting. That kind of segues. I'll go into this really quickly and then get back to you directly. The September-October issue of Foreign Policy magazine has an article in it, or actually a series of essays.
Where do you get a subscription to that magazine?
I don't have any kind of subscription. I just picked it up from Barnes & Noble or whatever.
Oh, they have it at Barnes & Noble.
Yeah, I just got it there. But it's got a series of essays on the world's most dangerous ideas.
So, yeah, and I understand where you're going with this. That whole idea of being God-fearing and then taking
basically one of their one of their articles, though.
No sense at all.
One of their articles,
should we kill
specifically
them, like, harder because they take up arms in the name of God? And
that's where I'm going.
God believers?
That's where I'm going. They have one article
on
the war on evil, basically saying, having this concept that the other side is evil puts them in a light of saying that, well, they're just plain wrong. You can't reason with evil people.
Right.
You just have to kill them. And that's all there is to it.
Kind of like a chalkboard. They need to be erased off
the
chalkboard.
That's a dangerous idea. I don't think that is any kind of solution.
Right?
I don't think that's a solution.
Keryn with a Y. I want to know what you have to say.
Well,
you haven't spoken much.
Yeah. We'll get to you in a second.
Okay. What?
I swear.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You can answer in a second.
What's your name, Mac? Bill?
Ashley.
What's your name?
Ashley.
Mr. Morgan. Keryn with a Y.
Okay.
What are you...
we'll let Ashley say his part first, and then I'll say my part.
We're in control of the show here. So we're going to give our views, and you will get to speak, I promise.
I'm not pushing it.
Okay.
I don't like answering this question.
Okay. I don't think that again, putting the current situation with Iraq and Afghanistan, whatever, aside, I don't think war is always an answer. That is, in a way, why we have a show like this. Religious fundamentalism and the danger behind that grows more when they don't have opposition. If there is opposition in the media, if there is balance, then at least everyone is a little bit more open and accepting of other people's ideas. I think Christians are wrong. I really don't like a lot of the philosophies behind it. But I can understand their right to believe that stuff, and if that's what they want to do, that's fine. I'm accepting of that. It's in places where you don't have the two sides talking that one of them just kind of escalates into power, and there's nothing there to stop it. And that's where you can start killing the other people because they are infidels, or because they're witches, or because of whatever. And so I think having education out there, having everybody give their own speech, I think that's the best way to combat essentially fundamentalism. So, did you have something to add now?
I really don't have that much to add. You really wanted to hear my opinion. My opinion, I really don't have a good answer to it. I'm sorry. What was the question?
I assume just dealing with fundamentalism.
Dealing with,
fanatics.
Hateful ideas, fanatics. In my opinion, I do believe that more often than not, religion breeds hatred towards anybody that doesn't believe the same thing as them. I also did a show on the Atheist Experience about how, just like that, patriotism also breeds intolerance. I think that I'm very anti-patriotism and very anti-religion for that reason. I think that anything that makes you feel like you're better than everybody else and that everybody else deserves to die if they don't convert to what you believe is bad and wrong and dysfunctional. I don't think that fighting is the way to solve anything. I am very much a pacifist. I would say that before I refuse to date a Christian, I will refuse to date someone that is in the military, because they will have such dramatically different ideas about the world than me. I can't answer what I would do or how I would solve it or what is the perfect answer if someone is trying to attack and kill me.
I can't answer that. I don't have an answer for it. I don't think that war and fighting is the right way to solve anything. I don't think the way to make peace in the world is whoever is disrupting the peace, just kill them all off. I don't agree with that.
We
but
want
I don't
peace
have the answer for you.
By killing the people who
right.
disturb it.
Right. I think that's very egocentrical. I think that I can respect, and this is a place where I've found that, you know, I've found more Christians who are closed-minded about this than atheists. I can respect the fact that other people have religion in their lives. I can't understand it, and I can't agree with it, and I can't identify with it. But I can respect it, and I can acknowledge it, because I mean, as far as I'm aware or concerned, I think that people tend to have religion in their lives because they need it to feel secure or to understand their own existence or to feel like they have a purpose or a meaning or just whatever, for whatever reason, I think that people have religion and God in their lives because they need it. And I can respect that. And so I'm not going to go off and kill somebody else because they're not an atheist. You know, I'm going to appreciate them for what they are. And I would date someone who doesn't agree with me as long as they respect me in the same way that I respect them. I don't have God in my life because it doesn't answer any questions for me, because I haven't been given appropriate evidence, but I still try to live my life as a good person. So I would hope that eventually, you know, through religion or without religion or whatever, we're all going to... can't we all just get along? Okay, that's my answer.
And I think the key to that is education and communication.
I think so too, which is the point of this show. We're trying to educate people and communicate with them so that they can understand us and respect us in the same way that we try to understand and respect them.
Exactly. We don't expect to convert anyone to atheism on this show.
Now, I'm not going to speak for
happen.
All atheists. Some atheists do want to convert all religious people to atheism, and some atheists don't respect religious people.
Right.
I mean, nobody in any group can be bunched into the same set of beliefs.
Yeah.
Okay. So, next.
All right. Okay. Next, we're going to go on to Jacob. How you doing?
Hi. How y'all doing?
Yeah, pretty well. What you got for us?
Yeah, just to let y'all know, I used to be an atheist as well. I was an atheist for 8 years.
Okay.
And just to let you know, I respect y'all's opinion. Everybody has their own opinion, and everybody's entitled to it. I just want to say on you, ma'am, I'm sorry, I don't know your
Keryn.
Name, but anyway, Tara, hi. Yeah, but you said you read the Bible and everything. You said you've read the whole Bible.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, reading the Bible is good, but if you're going to read the Bible without being intent on learning something and wanting to learn something, how are you going to pick it up?
I was intent on learning something, and I was intent on wanting to learn something, and I learned a whole lot.
And I was just going to say as well, you're saying Jesus and everything. Well, you said you read the Bible and everything. Well, then you should know that Jesus, God, and Lord, those names are made up. The real names are Yahweh and Yeshua. Jesus, Lord, and God are, they were made back in the day, because if you were to say their real names, you'd be. I'm sorry.
As a matter of fact, I come from Judaism, and I can tell you that the word Yahweh was also made up. The real name of God, as I've heard, I don't know the real name of God, involves every single letter in the Hebrew alphabet.
Yeah, and
a very,
say
very
if you
long
say
name.
The whole name, you'll undo the world.
Right.
That's a
movie abbreviation.
Right. The word Yahweh, as far as I'm aware, came from the movie Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom. But... No, where it comes from is in the Bible, in the Torah, in place of the name of God, they use a series of letters. There are four letters. There are a Yud, a He, a Vav, and a He, I think. And if you pronounce that out, it's Yahweh, but that was just inserted into the Torah as a substitution that we could use to refer to God in place of using his real name because of the bad implications of using the real name of God.
Just to get all into that, I was just going to say that those other names, that they're not real.
Okay, well, neither is Yahweh or Yehuda or whatever names you came up with.
But regardless of what name you apply to it, it's still the same story.
Concept.
Yeah, it's still the same concept.
Like I said, I used to be an atheist as well, and... you know, I'm not anymore, because I know. I think it's just more comforting to yourself to go ahead and deny, because you don't have to face the truth.
That's not anything I've ever heard anybody say before. I've usually heard someone say that they don't, they would be too afraid to deny God. Oh, not because they'd be afraid they go to hell.
Well,
but
don't get me wrong.
How can you bear the idea of death if you don't have God?
Just because I'm talking to you like this doesn't mean I'm all like a Bible boy or anything. It's just that I know the truth.
Yeah, and
it's true, because if you sit there and you deny it, it's true. If you deny it, you don't have to live.
And we have gotten that several times on this show, basically saying that atheism is such an easy way to go because you have no responsibility. You can go and kill and do whatever you want, and there's no final judgment. Go and have a good time. Problem with that is that I like my life. I have a pretty good time with it right now. Now, granted, the idea of going out and stealing a car, I mean, man, do I actually want to raise the money for that stupid thing? Not really. It'd be kind of cool to steal it. Problem is, I have a lot of time ahead of me in my life.
Uh-huh.
If I steal it, a significant portion of that is going to be spent in jail, or at least with a lot of people really hating me. That's not good.
Now, what's scary?
Now, what Christians can do, on the other hand, is Christianity is the way out. Christianity is the easy form in our opinion. Our way of looking at it, because hey, I can do whatever the hell I want as long as I get in bed at night and say, Jesus, I'm so sorry, forgive me, then I'm okay.
Well,
that's kind of cool.
I'm not really a Christian or anything. I believe that.
Well, then there goes that whole "you're not a real Christian" thing.
No, I'm what my belief is, there is no religion. All religion is, in my opinion, wrong, because for me, the only real way is that one person. And, you know, I don't want to tell you that because I don't want you to get offended or anything. But, I just tell you the truth. I would turn the TV on and I was just watching y'all's show, and I just couldn't understand on how y'all could just, you know, deny it. You know, I mean, in deep inside yourself, because I used to be an atheist. Deep inside yourself, there's a wanting. Yeah, you live.
Don't try and tell us what's in our hearts here.
No, I'm not. Yeah.
Because
okay,
trust
sorry,
me,
right.
I don't have this deep down desire to say,
that's
I feel empty
problem.
Inside.
No.
There's none of that.
I already addressed this earlier in the show today, if you didn't see it, but the word deny, the word against, the word refuse or reject, that we hear that a whole lot. That's a very religious-centric way of looking at it, because it's presupposing that there's a God out there to do that. And the problem is, people that don't believe in God don't believe in God. I don't believe there's a God out there. The thing is, I could want with all my heart to believe that there's a God out there, just like I want with all my heart to believe that there are fairies and unicorns in the world. Deep down in my heart, no matter how much I try and fake myself into believing it, or fool myself into believing it, or pretend that I believe it, or act like I believe it, I could go through my whole life, go to church every day, say, yes, I believe in God. Deep down in my heart, I just don't believe that God exists. That doesn't mean that I'm against God. That doesn't mean that I reject God, because I can't reject something that doesn't exist.
Because you've never seen him?
Because I've never seen him, I've never seen any proof of him, I've never seen any evidence of him, I've never seen any scientific evidence.
Do you believe in $1 million?
Huh?
Do you believe in $1 million?
I don't understand
the
question.
Do you believe in $1 million in cash?
Do I believe that it exists?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, have you ever seen it? $1 million in cash.
On TV and on the mint, yes.
Yes.
So?
I'm talking about in front of your face.
Does it matter? I know.
I'm just saying.
No, the point is, I know coins exist. I know bills exist. I know how they work. I know they're printed. I know that they're what they're made of. That kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So the fact that I haven't seen $1 million actually sitting on this table, not so big an issue, because I know how each of the components is made. And so you put enough of them together, and it exists. Now, to jump from that to saying some all-knowing, all-loving, all-caring being exists who created the world, but you can't see or touch him, and trust me, he really cares about your sex life, that I don't care, that I have no evidence of. If you're going to postulate something that is so wacky, then we need some evidence of that.
Something,
I know money is real.
Anything.
Money is physical and real. God, not. So until there's some kind of evidence of God, I'm not going to take it.
Have you personally ever tried to believe, or you just...
Yes.
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
Yes.
Several times.
That's why I can tell you from experience that no matter how hard I try, there's still some little part down, deep down in me that just doesn't believe in God. It's like you get up on a bed.
I just hopefully one day, honestly hope that, you know, one day you'll change, because I used to be just like that, and I used to have people say, oh, you're, just like I'm telling you now, I just hope that you'll be open to things, and I know you've tried it and everything, but I just want to say that, honestly, it's real, and to believe in something, you have to want to, not just believe, because one of the big things that I used to say was like, well, if God knows everything, and he made everyone, and he loves his son, this world so much, he gave his one and only begotten son, la, 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 then why did he make a hell? Why did he make somebody
Let
to
me
burn
tell
himself?
You, when I was a little kid, my friends told me that if I really, really, really genuinely believed that I could fly, then I would be able to fly. And all you need to be able to fly is to believe that you can. And I wanted to fly so badly. And I would get up on my bed, and I would sit here, and I would close my eyes, and I would try and try and try to believe that I could, and I would jump off the bed, and it never worked. And the thing is that deep down in my heart, I always just, no matter how much I wanted it, no matter how much I wanted to fly, just could not believe that I could fly.
But so, you're not a bird.
For all I know, you don't have to be a bird to fly. Other things fly. Anyway, I mean, the point is, yes, I've been through phases in my life where I'm not there right now. Right now, I don't really necessarily want it. But I've been through phases in my life.
Exactly. Well, I just hope that y'all get
where
it right.
I really, really wanted to believe that God existed. All my friends believe in God. Mm-hmm. It seemed like God was so wonderful and loving. It seemed like heaven was such a great place to be. It seemed like God had so much to offer. It seemed like God was such a popular thing to believe in. But just no matter how hard I tried, no matter how hard I said that I believed in God, I even went through a phase in my life where I called myself a deist, because I knew that I couldn't believe in God, but I could convince myself, I could pretend that at some point in history there had been a God, he just isn't here anymore. I tried that for a little while to see if it would help me convince myself there was a God, but no matter how much I wanted it, I just did not believe that he existed. No matter how much I want to believe in unicorns and fairies, I just don't believe in unicorns and fairies. I've read books about them. I've seen pictures of them.
That's not an answer.
Well, how do you think that we got here? Do you think we're just obsolete animals with intelligent brains?
Yes.
I don't know about the word obsolete, but we got here. I mean, the reason that we're here, we have whole areas of science: cosmology, biology, chemistry, and so on.
My mother and my father had.
They give
sex.
Pretty explanations of how why things are the way that they are.
My mother got pregnant.
So.
9 months later,
a little miracle happened.
I popped out of her uterus. Okay.
Okay. Well, that's pretty much all I got to say. I appreciate y'all's time, and I just hope y'all get it right, because the way this world and this government's working right now, open your eyes to that, and maybe you'll get it done.
Well, I'm glad that you hope for us, and
God
maybe
bless
you pray hard.
Y'all have a nice day.
Okay. Thanks for calling.
Did I just share too much about my mother and father? Was that supposed to be a secret?
Yeah, acknowledging that there are problems in the world is not proof that there's a God. Again, as much as I like the idea of God, again, assuming that he's this loving being.
I don't, yeah, assuming
who,
that he's
who
a loving
really,
being.
Really cares for you and stuff like that, and he's going to bring you to heaven and stuff like that. I love the idea. I'm all for heaven.
Sure.
Doesn't mean I believe it.
Right.
I'm all for Santa. Getting presents every year just
and
for being good.
Fairy.
That'd be awesome.
The tooth fairy is real cool.
I'm past that one.
You can't count one of your teeth and then you get money.
Yeah, but the amount of money you got wasn't all that good. And so nowadays, since I've lost my baby teeth, don't need it so much. But when I was a kid, damn yeah.
Yeah, heck yeah.
But anyway, it doesn't exist, and wanting it ain't going to make it happen. So anyway, let's go on to... Okay. Go on to... Tim, how you doing?
Hey, how's it going, guys?
Okay.
Yeah, a set of teeth will cost you $1,000, $2,000 these days.
Exactly. I don't think Tooth Fairy's up to that much yet. So.
Hey, I had a quick question for you. It's really more of a question of semantics than anything else. I consider myself agnostic.
Okay.
And I've always thought that the difference between agnostic and atheism was that atheists said, you know, that God doesn't exist, absolutely.
Okay.
There is no God, yeah. End of discussion.
Yeah.
Whereas agnostics were kind of, you know, they kind of
on
thought,
the fence.
They kind of think that, you know, I don't have any proof of a God, therefore
yeah.
I don't believe in God, but,
okay.
you know, show me proof in the future and
yeah.
I might, you know.
Yeah. We've gotten this question a couple times, so you want to answer this one.
Mm-hmm.
Go
Yay.
For it.
We've gotten this question a lot.
Yeah, I figured you had.
The word atheist in Latin means a, which is the prefix for without, and theist meaning God or religion. Okay, so the word atheist means without God or religion. It's pretty much that simple. The word agnostic also means without, and gnosis meaning knowledge. So the word agnostic means without knowledge. So you can very easily be an agnostic atheist or an agnostic theist. It basically means, you know, the difference between, I mean, the atheists live without God because we do not believe they exist.
Right.
I'm not saying that I know there is no God. I have not been shown enough proof to prove that there's no God. But I have also not been shown enough proof to believe that there is a God.
Right.
So I don't believe in God. I am an agnostic atheist. I don't know that there's a God, but I don't believe in one. I'm not saying that I would think an agnostic theist or an agnostic atheist are kind of scary people. The ones that say, I know for a fact that there is a God. And I would say
turn your
having
home.
Some,
yeah.
having some camera issues, I'm sorry. I would say that, you know, most theists in the entire universe, with a rare few exception, are agnostic theists. They believe in God.
Right.
Most theists will tell you they believe in God. I think that, I don't know, I mean, that's pretty much it. Did it answer your question?
Yeah, more or less. It's like I said, it's a semantic question.
Yeah, let me take a quick stab here. Again, Gnosticism, agnosticism, what you know, theism, atheism, what you believe. Most people are agnostic.
Yeah.
Most people admit that they don't know for a fact, they can't prove that God exists or doesn't, but they choose to believe or they choose not to. I'm an agnostic atheist. I can't prove it,
yeah.
but I don't believe God exists. Most people will say, I can't prove it, but I think God does exist.
Mm-hmm.
Atheist, agnostic atheist.
Well, that's an interesting point, because that kind of brings up a question of faith, because I guess you're saying that a lot of atheists have faith, because atheists have faith that there's not a God, because they can't
prove
it.
No.
Faith in a God, but faith that there's not a God.
No, because we have lack of belief.
Right.
I am not... To take this to a different example, going back to what you were saying earlier, unicorns. I'm not saying unicorns don't exist. They cannot exist. It's impossible. I'm saying I haven't seen any. I don't choose to believe in it.
I'm not even saying I have faith in the fact
so,
that unicorns don't exist. I'm just saying
haven't
I don't
seen
believe
any?
They exist.
Haven't seen any? Don't believe in them.
Okay.
That's different from saying they don't exist.
Right.
That's a hard line. Gnostic
and
atheism.
A lot of theists will try and present that argument to us saying, well, by rejecting God you're proving that there's a God to reject.
No, see I believe everything you guys say on
sure.
the show. I mean I guess you call me an atheist, but
yeah.
People don't like that word, so I try not to use that word.
Right.
I mean
a lot of agnostics the
know.
Reason agnosticism became a word that means what you originally started saying it means is pretty much because atheist is a dirty word.
Yeah, it's just
yeah,
kind of bad.
And it's a lot softer to call yourself an agnostic.
Yeah.
And
well,
a lot of people that aren't sure how they feel or are sure what they believe or are too afraid to admit what they believe will call themselves an agnostic just because it's sort of, it kind of has that on the fence feeling.
Yeah, yeah. That's it, yeah.
My response
right.
to that is don't treat atheist like a dirty word.
Well,
I mean, I had that.
Not me.
When I was a kid, you know, people would try and call me you Jew.
Yeah.
I was like, yeah, I am. That's very observant of you. What about it? Yeah. Like, I'm not going to respond to Jew like it's a dirty word. I am a Jew. Yeah. What about it?
Yeah. Yeah, there's more to atheism than, you know, old, bitter old men sitting in a coffee shop.
Pitching about.
Get me started.
I watch you guys quite often. I like what you have to say, and yeah. I get a kick out of a lot of the callers that call up, like that first guy that sounds like a Down syndrome patient or something.
It's a lot of fun, this show.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's it.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, thanks a lot for calling.
And if you enjoy it that much, come down to the bagel shop. Beignets.
Beignets.
Crescent City Beignets.
Yes, to any atheist-friendly people, Crescent City Beignets, every Sunday at 11:30, a couple blocks west of Lamar on West 6th Street.
Mm-hmm.
Come down and meet us down there. Let's go on to Nicole. How you doing?
Hello, Ashley.
Hello.
And Keryn. My name is Nicole, as you know. And I have, first of all, I want to commend you guys. You guys are very passionate about what you believe or what you say you don't believe. And you guys are exhausting a very lot of energy and time educating yourself about something that you don't believe in.
Okay.
And my question then to you is, if you don't believe in God, and if you're not rejecting God because you don't believe that God exists, and if you're not trying to convert people to atheism, why then would you exhaust so much of your time and energy trying to prove or help other people believe that God does not exist? I mean, is it deep down inside, are you looking, you really want to believe, kind of what you were saying earlier, Keryn, I wanted to believe, I just had no evidence.
Yeah.
But I believe that you really want to believe, and until you find that evidence, you know, you're not going to believe.
Yeah.
And I have another point before you
let's go ahead and let me answer that one quick, if you can
write
the other down for a minute. If someone is out there and they have evidence of God, and they can prove it, I want them to call in. It would be kind of nice to know for a fact that God does or does not exist. But beside that, of why we do this show, it's mostly education and outreach. It's telling people that atheists are not baby-eating, grumpy old men and monsters, which is what the churches usually say. We're out here to reach out to other atheists. If you're an atheist and, you know, you're feeling isolated because Christians, let's face it, can be a little bit pushy. There's an atheist organization in town. Come down and meet us and be, you know, get some more people under your, some more friends.
It's social?
Exactly, it's social. But as to why doing the show, I'm going everywhere with this.
Want some help?
Yeah, go for it. Take it away.
Yeah, I mean, the purpose of the show is largely educational. With pretty much anything in all of history, if you don't understand it, then you're afraid of it and you hate it. And a big reason we do the show is to prove that we're not bad guys, that we're not uneducated, that we're not out to get you, and you know, that we didn't cause 9/11, and that we didn't, you know, like Ashley said, we don't eat babies. I mean, the point of the show is we want to introduce ourselves to people that don't believe in us and talk about why we don't believe what we believe. If people want to call into the show and ask us questions, we can clarify them for them. You know, mostly a lot of people in the universe have never met an atheist, and everything they know about atheists is something they've learned from their preacher and is more likely than not true. I'm not the Antichrist, and I didn't kill Christ. I didn't even know Christ.
The Bible never said that an atheist killed Christ.
Well, no, the Bible said that Jews killed Christ, okay? And the Bible said that atheists are going to be the Antichrist, and I'm not the Antichrist, okay? I think that a lot of what he had to say was
good. Can you tell me where in the Bible it says that? Because I'd like to look that up, that the atheist is going to be the Antichrist.
I don't know that one specifically.
Towards the end where it starts talking about the end of days.
I think there's something in Revelation about it.
I don't have the Bible on me, so I can't look it up.
Yeah.
But, you know, where it starts talking about the end of days and the, where in the Bible it talks about the Antichrist, it says it's going to be a non-believer.
And going back to what the point I forgot was, again, the energy we're putting into the show and stuff like that. Christians a lot of times spend, again, talking about Christians in this country, spend a lot of time and energy trying to impose their beliefs on everyone else. And I'm against that. I respect everyone's right. If you want to be a Christian, if you want to believe in God, Muslim, Buddhism, whatever, go right ahead. I don't mind. As soon as you start saying, well, I'm a Christian, and I think that you should live this way because I know what's right, that's where I start having issues. And so Christians are out there trying to impose their beliefs on everyone else. We're going to try and have this TV show and say, look, there are other ways to look at the world. Maybe the Christians don't have it all right.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And it's kind of a haven. You know, we spend our entire lives, you know, being bombarded with all this atheists are evil and gay people are evil and Christianity is the only way to go. We have to suffer through prayer in schools. We have to suffer through being forced to say the Pledge of Allegiance. There's a lot of exhausting stuff in our life that comes from the fact that other people are pushing their values on us. And it's just nice to be able to get together, know that there's an atheist group out there that we can just get together with and kind of take a break from it. Be around people who are like-minded. Be around people who say, it's okay to believe what you believe. I agree with you. Let's move on and talk about something else.
Okay, if your whole point then is to let other atheists know that, hey, there's a group in town who believe or don't believe what you believe or don't believe, you know, here's when we meet, you know, this is where we meet, why then do you sit in a television show and prepare for a television show for hours at a time, exhausting your studies and reading books about things that you don't believe in.
Okay.
And here's another,
because again, Christians are doing...
That was not a direct question, okay, because you've answered that. That was more rhetorical.
Yeah.
I want to respond to what Keryn said when she said, you know, I'm an atheist, I didn't cause 911. Well, again, I don't believe that anyone ever said an atheist caused 911.
Oh,
actually,
there was a half-page ad issue, and the Muslims were killing people for not believing what
there were articles and editorials out there saying it was the atheistic point of view that caused this.
There was a half-page article in the New York Times shortly after 9/11 saying that the reason this happened is because we've moved away from God, and we've gotten too secular as a community, and because of that, we need to get back to God, or, you know, God is going to punish us again.
Yeah.
Okay. It was an atheistic view, not necessarily an atheist.
It was an atheist excuse?
View. You said it was an atheistic
view. She said atheistic view.
Oh, atheistic view. How was it an atheistic view
that's
what you said.
Okay.
I do want to make a point. You know, earlier you were talking about, you know, how no Christians can agree, and you know, one Christian says this, another one says that.
Yeah.
You know, who's right? You know, I do want to make it clear that you guys sat there and contradicted yourselves just a few minutes ago. Keryn, you said, A means without, and theist means God or religion. It doesn't mean that you said something like, I don't know if there is or is not a God. So because I've never seen one, I don't believe in it because there's no evidence. Ashley, you turned around seconds later and said, I've never seen one, so I know there's no God. So I want to make it very clear that even though there are times when Christians believe different things, you guys are obviously not agreeing with each other. I mean, and it was
pointed out right there.
Not everyone is going to agree 100% all the time.
Yeah, and maybe we didn't explain that clearly enough, but agnosticism is what you don't, it's knowledge. Again, I can't prove that God didn't exist. I don't know it. You can't prove it. You don't know it for a fact, but you choose to believe. I choose not to.
Exactly.
I would actually take out the word choose from that sentence you just said. You believe and we don't. That's the only difference.
So you don't choose to believe?
I do not choose not to believe. I have no evidence that causes me to believe. If it were my choice, I might be a believer. But I can't choose what to believe and what not to believe. Like I was saying earlier on the show, no matter how hard I want to believe, I cannot choose to believe in unicorns. Because deep down inside, I don't believe they exist. Whether or not I want to believe in them, I don't believe in them.
You could fool yourself into thinking if that were the case. I mean, if you really wanted to trick yourself.
No.
Yeah, you can do that.
No, you can't.
Some people have done that before.
I don't think you can.
And it's kind of nutsy to do that because
I don't.
You could try and convince yourself of anything, but
I disagree. That'd make it real. I don't think you can convince yourself of anything. I don't think that any human on the planet can honestly convince themselves they can fly.
Well, I mean,
and no matter how much they want to believe they can fly,
right, you just defy the laws of gravity. So, I mean, in your immaturity and as a child, you wanted to believe that you could fly, and that was an impossibility because you defy the laws of gravity.
I would still like to believe that I could fly.
You could fly. I mean, just strap yourself to some hoisters.
No, that I can fly.
I mean, you know what I'm saying?
I'm not saying that my airplane can fly. I'm saying I would like to believe that I can fly. But I am a rational, logical human being, and all scientific evidence that I've been given has pointed to the fact that I cannot fly for these aerodynamic reasons.
Exactly.
And no matter how much I want to believe that I can fly, I want to believe it. I really do. I would like to fly. I have reoccurring dreams about flying. Most people do. I want to fly. But no matter how much I want it, I can't believe it. That's why I say I cannot choose whether or not I believe in something.
Okay.
I believe in it or I don't. And no matter how much I want to believe there's a God, I don't believe in God.
You want to believe that there's a God, but you don't. Is that what you just said?
I'm saying no matter how much I want to believe in God, I don't. Right. I am clarifying my statement, okay? When I was younger, I went through a phase in my life where I really, really wanted to believe in God. But I just couldn't. I just didn't believe in God. I did not have enough scientific evidence for God, and I had too much scientific evidence against God. This was when I was very young. I mean, people assume that something horrible had to happen to me to make me reject God, and that's not what happened. I did not have enough evidence to prove God. I wanted to believe in God, and I didn't.
So is it the only thing that needs to change your mind, then, Keryn, is scientific evidence that makes you believe in God?
Yeah.
That would certainly help.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I'm not saying, and that's what I mean when I say that I don't know that there's not a God. I am open-minded about it. If someone showed me evidence, I would believe in God. But that's the difference between having faith and not having faith. The movie Dogma. Have you seen the movie Dogma? I know a lot of atheists whose big problem with that movie is that in the end of the movie, God shows up. God performs a miracle right in front of everybody. God walks up to the main character, the woman, and tweaks her nose and makes a little rant noise, okay? And then disappears. And then the muse turns to her and says, "So how's your faith now?" And she says, "It's pretty strong." That is not faith. When God is standing in front of you, talking to you, touches you, and performs a miracle in front of your eyes, on camera, because there were cameras everywhere, because this whole thing was being televised, and the camera can be replayed over and over again, and there were no special effects, and you've proven, basically, that there is a God, that's not faith. I have no faith that there is a God. If someone proved to me there would be a God, I would believe in God. It's not that I would have faith that there is a God. It's that I would believe in God because I had been given proof. I believe this cup is sitting in front of me because I can touch it. I can smell it. I can taste it. I can, you know, scientifically prove. I can break this glass and then I can, you know, look at it under a microscope and I can take pictures of it and I can recreate this glass. I know this glass is there. I believe this glass is there. Maybe we're living in the Matrix and this glass isn't really here. I don't know. Okay, but I believe this glass is here for all evidence that I have in front of me. I have not been given proof that there is a God, and therefore I don't believe in God.
I do have what I believe is my final statement or question, and that is, earlier you referred to faith as being a squishy feeling or someone lusting after something.
Mm-hmm.
And in that, you know, you can't tell me that if I have cancer and I have the faith to believe that God is going to heal me, I want you to know that that's bigger than a squishy feeling. That's not I'm lusting after God because I want to be healed. That is, I am getting on my knees and I am praying and I am crying out to God because I choose to believe that there is a God and his name is Jehovah Rapha and he is my healer. And I know that you have an issue with the name and we're not going to, I mean, that's irrelevant.
Actually, but just no, that was somebody else brought up to
me. How do you explain people
Let me ask you a
have
question.
Been healed? How do you explain people whose limbs have grown back when
well,
they
let me ask
when
you
they,
a question, okay?
How do you explain those things?
Okay.
I'm going to
tell me that that's
wait,
a squishy feeling. It's more than
Go.
You're asking me questions and you're not giving me an opportunity to answer, okay?
And I'm sorry, we do have 1 minute left.
I want to answer your question. But I'm going to turn it around. And if we don't have time to actually get to the answer, then I'm going to pose it to all of you theists out there in the entire universe when it comes to a matter of choice. Whether it's God or being gay or believing in unicorns, whatever. If you wanted it badly enough, could you not believe in God? Okay, I know that you have a very, very strong feeling about God, so no matter how badly you wanted it, could you really erase the idea of God from your minds? I mean, I know that it's strong for you, and I know that you believe in God, and I want to know if you tried hard enough, if you could believe that God didn't exist.
Okay, and that is all that we have time for on the show this week. Thank you, Keryn, very much for coming on and helping out.
Thank you for having me.
If you're left on the line, and I'm very sorry to Nicole that we had to cut you off. We had so little time left. tv@atheist-community.org. If you have any other questions or comments, go ahead and write us at that address, and we'll try and answer via email or on the air. See you next week.